Prominent figures. The Ethiopian delegation met with President Abdel Fattah el-Sisi, Prime Minister Ibrahim Mahlab, Foreign Minister Sameh Shukri, Al-Azhar Grand Imam, Sheikh Ahmad al-Tayyib, and Coptic Orthodox Pope Tawadros II. The delegation also met the Egyptian public diplomacy delegation that visited Ethiopia in 2012, along with members of the Egyptian Council for Foreign Affairs and the Ethiopian-Egyptian Business Council. The Ethiopian delegation is the first of its kind to visit Egypt. The goal was to further strengthen the good relations between Ethiopia and Egypt and set the basis for consolidating people-to-people ties. Peace in Focus spoke exclusively to Honorable Abdullah Gemeda. Ethiopia and Egypt are bound by long and deeply rooted ties dating back to the early 25th century BCE, to the reign of 5th dynasty pharaoh Sahura, when ancient Egypt first traded with the land of Punt. Coptic Christianity was introduced into Ethiopia from Egypt in the 4th century. Modern diplomatic relations between both countries were established in 1927, and they are the oldest in Africa and one of the oldest in the world. Before the 1952 Egyptian Revolution, Egypt had only one diplomatic mission in Africa, which was in Ethiopia. Your Excellency, as an Ethiopian citizen and an influential politician, how do you evaluate Ethiopian-Egyptian relations today?
As you mentioned, the Ethiopian-Egyptian relation is long back, before the modern statehood created in this area. And all civilization are connected. The pyramid, the Pharaoh pyramid was Aksumite kingdom and others. And nowadays, in modern era, the two countries have a strong relationship, culture, tradition, history, and of course we share one river. So our relation is deep-rooted, extremely deep-rooted. But according to my evaluation, we are not using this deep-rooted relationship to our benefits, to benefit to the Egyptian people and the Ethiopian people, both sides. Nowadays, we are started to think. I know during the Emperor Haile Selassie and Gamal Abdel Nasser, those two leaders had a good relation. And also they were the good leader of Africa in this area, not only for the region, not only for their, for the two countries. They were leading Africa. And they were coming together, they were moving together. After that, there was interruption. Not because of the problem between Egypt and Ethiopia, because of our problem, internal problem.
In reaction to your visit, Egyptian President Abdel Fattah el-Sisi has expressed readiness to visit the Ethiopian parliament and address the Ethiopian people through their own parliament. His message will probably be that it is the right of the Ethiopian people to develop, and it is the right of the Egyptian people to protect and secure their water interests in the Nile River to be able to live.
It is the first time if His Excellency President came and addressed directly the Ethiopian people through the parliament. It is a breakthrough.
Really?
For our relationship, for our negotiation, for our everything. Because we are not enemies. Why we are sit far away? It's good to talk our interests. So if you know our interests, both sides, and we can narrow it, our differences. And this is not only the issue of the government. It's the issue of the Egyptian people, it's the issue of the Ethiopian people. So if the president came and explained, addressed the parliament, and through the parliament to the Ethiopian people, We are very glad.
Diplomatic relations between Egypt and Norway were established in 1936. The Middle East file is one of the areas of cooperation between both countries. Commenting on the Palestinian-Israeli conflict, you said, and I quote, "I have seen peace work," unquote. When have you seen it work, and where?
The 1973 war put pressure on Israel, and the Israelis ran to Camp David to have an agreement with Egypt. But other than the war of 1973, the other opportunity was in 1991, when the Soviet Union collapsed, the Cold War ended, the Americans occupied the Gulf, and as a result, there was one power in this world that did not even feel that Israel was an important strategic asset. And so they forced Mr. Shamir to come to Madrid, and they put all the pressure, including $10 billion, in order to get the Israelis to a peace process. I mean, otherwise, tell me, what other peace processes have succeeded other than these two opportunities, the 1973 war opportunity and the collapse of the Soviet Union and the occupation of the West of the Arab Gulf as a result?
It worked in 1993, 1994. It worked, but
because of the conditions I talked about. As a result of these conditions, the Israelis changed their leadership, brought Mr. Yitzhak Rabin to be their president, who understood really that this was a time where Israel needs to go to peace in order to benefit from the changes in the world. And he, I think, with our equally assassinated president, the two presidents were assassinated, Rabin and Arafat. These two assassinated presidents later took the decision to go to peace, and peace for 2-3 years prospered. The Israelis withdrew from Gaza and then from all the major cities of the West Bank. 250,000 Palestinians were allowed to return. The leadership of the Palestinian people went into the West Bank and Gaza. We had and started an authority which really was able to start building and growing and creating opportunities. Negotiations were useful and bringing results. And then Israeli extremists assassinated Rabin. And the world changed. And Mr. Netanyahu came to become prime minister in 1996, and everything was stalled.
Egypt, Norway, together with Palestinian President Mahmoud Abbas, hosted the Cairo International Conference on Palestine and Reconstructing Gaza in October 2014. The conference occurred following a ceasefire agreement between Hamas and Israel, brokered by Egypt in August 2014. What are the objectives of the Cairo International Conference on Palestine and Gaza Reconstruction hosted by Egypt and Norway? In what way is it a window of opportunity?
I would say that there are three main objectives. Firstly, we have to support the Palestinian people in Gaza. We cannot just neglect that children don't get education, that buildings and houses are destroyed. There are immediate humanitarian needs. Then we have to rebuild and support in that. Secondly, we need to have a mechanism for monitoring what goes into Gaza. We need this to function well. We need a lot of cement, we need a lot of medicines, we need a lot of investments in Gaza, but we have to make sure that these investments, and this is not used for new tunnels or rockets, it has to be used on the civilians, and the civilians need this support. Then we need also to increase the political pressure on Israel to lift the blockade. And thirdly, and in collaboration with the Egyptian government, my colleague Foreign Minister Shukri, we also have focused a lot on the importance of having this as a starting point to revive the political talks on a two-state solution. Without a two-state solution based on the 67 borders, there is no hope for a lasting peace in this region.
عملية إعادة الإعمار وتلبية احتياجات المواطنين في قطاع غزة تستند إلى محورين أساسيين، وهما التهدئة الدائمة وممارسة السلطة الوطنية لصلاحياتها في القطاع، وعلينا جميعا أن نرتكز عليهما وألا نخذل الشعب الفلسطيني الذي يعلق على هذا المؤتمر آمالا كبيرة لكنها أكثر تواضعا إذا ما قيست بإمكانيات المجتمع الدولي.
For more details about Egypt-Norway relations and areas of cooperation, Peace and Focus spoke to Tor Venesland, Norway's ambassador to Egypt and non-resident ambassador to Libya from 2012 to August 17, 2015. Venesland was ambassador of Norway to the Palestinian Authority in Ramallah between 2008 and December 2011. Venesland has been appointed Norway's special envoy to the Middle East and will perform his duties starting August 18th.
Norway's Foreign Minister Berge Brende has been traveling to Egypt many times during your own term in office. What would you tell us about relations between Norway and Egypt today?
Yeah, well, that's the fantastic part of it. I mean, in times of changes in Egypt, very demanding to handle, we have succeeded together, Egypt and Norway, to develop our relationship, to widen them and to deepen them. And I don't think the bilateral relations between Egypt and Norway has been better ever since 1952.
Really?
Really.
Why so?
I think it's there's a lot to do, first of all, with the politicians. I mean, Egypt and Norway do have two ministers that easily talk together, that do have a lot of informal contacts that are outside the public domain, that are outside the framework of visits. They meet informally around in the world and they get very well on together. I think that's a very important part of it. Secondly, there are agendas we share. We share some of the agendas and challenges in the Middle East. We are far away, you are in the middle of it. But we have invested a lot to build up a knowledge base in Norway on the Middle East, and we talk well together. The third thing is that it has been a shift when it comes to our economic relations. At the end of 2011, the investments from Norway and Egypt was around £800 million. At the end of 2014, it is £4.1 billion in 32 different Egyptian companies. And there are more to come, seriously more to come. Norwegian companies are today involved in providing extra electricity to Egypt. That's why we don't have blackouts. The companies that has been here has been growing, and it's not something induced by the government. It's something done by people who do business and that think this is a place to go. So we have more type of relations. They're wider, they're deeper, they're more complex, and that's good. There has also been a different environment. I mean, there is now established a very good and formal relationship between our church and our bishops and Pope Tavadros. He has been to Norway and he has been meeting with his fellow religious leaders. So we are cementing these contacts in very different areas, and that is why I can say it has never been like this since 1952.
Welcome to Peace and Focus. I'm Mona Swelem in Entebbe, Uganda. The Nile Basin Initiative, NBI, is a regional intergovernmental partnership launched in 1999. Today, the NBI includes 10 members and Eritrea participates as an observer. I spoke to NBI Executive Director John Rao Nyaoro about how to develop the Nile River Basin in a cooperative manner and promote regional peace and security. From Lake Victoria, thank you so much for joining Peace in Focus and have a pleasant viewing. Egypt is an arid country, facing many challenges due to its limited freshwater resources. The Egyptian government is succeeding in resolving the problem of regular power cuts. But even the building of the Nile Basin Initiative, the NBI, that overlooks Lake Victoria, is also hit by power outages. Lake Victoria is considered the second largest area freshwater lake in the world, with a surface area of about 68,800 square kilometers. Lake Victoria is the eighth largest by volume, holding a freshwater volume of about 2,760 billion cubic meters per year, which is about 33 times the 84 billion cubic meters per year of Nile flow, originally measured at Aswan in southern Egypt. The Nile is the longest river in the world, flowing north for about 6,825 kilometers. The Nile River Basin is shared by 11 countries. The NBI slogan is One River, One People, One Vision. The objective of the NBI shared vision is to achieve sustainable socio-economic development through equitable utilization of and benefit from the common Nile Basin water resources. Prior to the emergence of the Nile Basin Initiative, there was no institutionalized and structured mechanism that was all-inclusive, bringing together all the Nile riparian countries to address a common agenda. The Undugo was one of several initiatives created before the NBI. The Undugo, meaning fraternity in Swahili, focused on the establishment of a Nile Basin economic community. Dr. Boutros Boutros-Ghali was Egypt's Minister of State for Foreign Affairs at the time of launching the Undugo in 1983. Dr. Boutros-Ghali was Secretary General of the United Nations between 1992 and 1996. You proposed establishing the Undugo Group in 1983, and it only lasted for 10 years. Dr. Boutros, what were the objectives, what were the challenges, and why did it fail?
I was in favor of a creation of an organization.
Yes.
Which will dealing with the problem of the Nile, the navigation, the irrigation, the problem of distribution of water. This has been done in Asia. What is the great river of Asia? The Mekong.
Yes.
I sent the minister, I paid for the minister of irrigation of all the African countries to pay visits to Asia and to see the Mekong and the organization of the Mekong.
Yes.
I've done a lot of work, but I'm sorry I failed. I've not been successful.
But what about the Undugo?
I failed too. Nobody take care about Undugo when I left.
Was this the real problem, or that the Undugo itself, can you describe the Undugo for me first?
The Undugo is a first step. It needs a lot of work to move from a first step to a second step. Then you say, oh, Undugo is not serious. But it is better than nothing. When I left, nobody took care about the Undugo group.
What were the challenges, sir?
Challenge was to pay more attention to each other. We don't enter in the detail. We can have more trade between those countries, more specialists working in this country.
The Nile Basin Initiative was conceived as a transitional institution until the agreement on the Nile River Basin Cooperative Framework, the CFA, enters into force and a permanent institution is created. The Nile River Basin Commission, the NRBC, will be established after six NBI member states ratify the CFA. The CFA was opened for signature in 2010. It was signed by Ethiopia, Kenya, Rwanda, Tanzania, and Uganda in 2010, and by Burundi in 2011. The CFA was ratified by Ethiopia and Rwanda in 2013, and by Tanzania in 2015. The Democratic Republic of Congo and South Sudan have not signed the agreement,
and Eritrea is not an MBI member state. Egypt and Sudan took part in launching the MBI and in the CFA negotiations, but both countries suspended their MBI membership in protest over the signing of the CFA in 2010 and pending the realization of a solution to the unresolved points of dispute. Article 14B of the signed CFA is one of the unresolved issues. Sudan reactivated its MBI membership in 2013. Egypt has not boycotted the Nile Council of Ministers, NILCOM, comprised of ministers in charge of water affairs in each of the MBI member states. NILCOM is the highest decision and policy-making organ of the MBI. Egypt has been boycotting the MBI technical level meetings. Egypt has been trying to cooperate to resolve problems peacefully and without delay and to reach a win-win situation. Egypt asked for an extraordinary meeting to discuss the legal and institutional consequences of signing the CFA in 2010. Egypt asked for this immediately after the signing in 2010, but no meeting has been held since then. Peace in Focus spoke to President of the Arab Water Council and Honorary President of the World Water Council, Dr. Mahmoud Abu Zayd, who played a pivotal role in launching the MBI in 1999. He also took part in the CFA negotiations in his capacity as Egypt's Minister of Water Resources and Irrigation between 1997 and 2009.
How successful have you been as Minister of Water Resources and Irrigation while dealing with the water file?
I think I have been very successful. You could see that from the actions taken with respect to the initiation of the cooperation between the Nile Basin countries, the MBI, the sort of projects which have joint projects which have taken place. And I remember when I first came to post, and I would go to Addis Ababa, the people will say, why are you coming? You are taking all our waters. And the taxi driver would refuse to take me in his taxi. And I would meet a minister or an official without talking to them. That was in the early days after I became a minister. But now, things are quite different. And I remember meeting the late President Meles Zenawi. I used to see him every time I go to Ethiopia. And I told him, what do you think about the NBI? He said that the best achievement that took place since NBI is confident building, that lots of confident building have taken place. Now we talk to each other, we are friends, we are welcomed in Ethiopia, they are welcomed here, we are getting closer.
Peace and Focus visited the Secretariat of the Nile Basin Initiative in Entebbe, Uganda, for more insight into the role of the MBI and how it's managing to survive and perform its duties. We spoke to Executive Director of the Nile Basin Initiative, John Raunia Oro, HSC.
The MBI congratulated Egypt, Ethiopia and Sudan, three MBI member states, on signing the Declaration of Principles concerning the Grand Ethiopian Renaissance Dam in March 2015, and it offered its assistance. We did not hear about any attempts by the MBI to resolve the problem or conflict in the past. How can the MBI help today?
MBI was there. They were only not being visible at the forefront. They were behind building capacity of this basin state, looking at the best principles, looking at what is the prevailing international law on the utilization of the shared project of shared water resources, like the Grand Ethiopian Dam that was being built. What are the best principles? And by building their capacity and analyzing those principles, they came to agree first the best principle, which is acceptable and the prevailing under the international water law today, is equitable and reasonable utilization. The second principle is prevention of harm to any other basin state. That is called causing no significant harm to any basin state. And those were the leading principles. The other principle was about cooperation. You can only achieve two, or balance, equitable, reasonable utilization, and causing no significant harm if you agree to cooperate. So NBI played that role. And also, in the past, and also, NBI, as it starts today, is a transitional institution. It does not have that permanent mandate to force the member state. Now look, you must were there to 1, 2, 3 principle. We are waiting for the cooperative framework, fully agreed, ratified, being enforced, established a permanent commission, which shall be able to develop rules for all this basin state, that if you want to develop a similar kind of project, you must abide with 1, 2, 3 in terms of rules and procedures. So NBI is still lacking that teeth.
The Nile Basin Initiative was conceived as a transitional institution until the CFA enters into force and a permanent institution, the Nile River Basin Commission, is created. The commission will be established after 6 countries ratify the CFA, and so far 3 countries have ratified the agreement. Do you expect the commission to be established anytime soon, and how important is the commission?
Since the 10 Nile Basin states had agreed to go to the negotiation table and they negotiated a document that reached up to the signing and process of ratification, I still believe that kind of objective that made them establish the NBI and that track of coming up with a cooperative framework is still there. What needs to be done is to sort out any issue, resolve any issue that is still not fully accepted in the CFA, to bring all the Nile Basin states that negotiated it to be on board of the CFA. And I want to tell you, ratification is going on, and very soon the 6 countries will be able to have ratified. But that is not, as an ED, I only would want to see. I would want to see all the Nile Basin states being a party to that agreement. And some of them have stated very clearly, if we cannot resolve Article 14B, which is about the water security, then it will be difficult for us to be a party. So at the NBI, we are doing research on how best that Article 14B can be resolved. Immediately, the new commission is established. If you look at when that Article 14B was annexed, he said it would be resolved by the new established Nile River Basin Commission 6 months after its establishment. But we want to prepare them. It will be just be a changeover. Immediately have come, we have done enough research, best practices of Nile River Basin Organization, said water resources can be used, how this problem, which is unique to the Nile, can be resolved, and we shall be telling them, look, this is how we have done our research, the best practices. The solution to this Article 14B should be this. This is the line we should be able to pursue and involve the countries, the basin state, so that we get a solution, so that all of them come on board. This is a shared resources, is key to all the basin state, and especially even those states who have not signed the Nile River water resources is key to them, is about their livelihood. So, and I know they will come on board once the solution of Article 14B is found.